Hi, everyone. It's Plastic EP here again from Melbourne, Australia. And let me tell you, I've got a very, very special VIP guest coming in from Beverly Hills. We don't get too many people coming in from Beverly Hills because, you know, hey, that's a real affluent suburb there in the States. But let me tell you, we've got Seth Swirsky, songwriter extraordinaire, filmmaker, recording artist. This guy's done everything and won so many awards. How are you today, Seth?
I am feeling groovy.
That's what we want to hear because the world is through a pandemic at the moment. So let's make everyone feel groovy.
Hey, bananas, we think you're groovy. Hey, bananas, we want you groovy. Driving June buggies everywhere. Just going crazy without a care. Hey, bananas, we think you're groovy. Hey, bananas, we think you're groovy. We love to watch you cause you're our favorite show.
Hey, bananas, we think you're groovy.
Hey, bananas,
hey, bananas, we think you're groovy.
Now, Seth, I've got to tell you, one of the greatest songs ever written was written by yourself. Tell it to my heart. You got to play a little bit for everybody. And what I'll do is I'll come out of the picture. Just play us a bit of the song. I love it. Here you go.
Tell it to my heart. Tell me I'm the only one. Is it really love or just a game? Tell it to my heart. I can feel your body rock. Every time you call my name.
Isn't that fantastic when the song comes to your head? And I just want to tell you, not that it matters. Hey, bananas, I think you're groovy. Came to me when I was in the bath. I was lying there and this song comes. Hey, bananas, we think you're groovy. That proves to me two things, Seth. One, you can write a song anywhere. And Two, you can stay clean in the meantime. Now, tell me, what was the inspiration for Tell It To My Heart? Where did that song come from?
Well, I was just thinking, you know, a lot of times guys try to get stuff over on girls, but a lot of times girls should just say, hey, you know, talk to my heart, talk to me personally, you know, don't just try to get your thing going on, you know. So it just seemed to have a message that people seem to hone in on, you know.
Well, I'm just saying that was a giant hit, especially here in Australia, let me tell you.
All right.
And I mean, every song is an inspiration to everybody, but not only do you write and record award-winning songs, I mean, you were Grammy nominated for that song, weren't you?
Yes, yes.
How big an event was that? When was that?
That was back in 87 or 88. Taylor Dane, who did the song, I wrote her first two top 10 songs. And she was nominated for her vocals and all the great stuff that she did. And then went on tour with Michael Jackson. It was a very exciting time. You can only imagine.
That is amazing. I've got to tell you. But not only that, being a filmmaker yourself, you did a Beatle documentary,
yes,
which is fantastic too, called The Beatle Stories. Just tell me a bit about that. What started you on that? When was that?
Well, I was in Liverpool and I was playing at the Cavern Club where the Beatles started, and I took a handheld camera and I started asking people about stories about the Beatles. And before I knew it, I was interviewing all my favorite people growing up, all the recording stars that had stories with them. And it won 20 film festival awards. It went on to, you know, it premiered in Paris and then London and all these places. And now it plays on Netflix and Hulu and Amazon Prime. And it just played in England again for the eighth year in a row. So if you get a chance, you know, called Beatles Stories, as you mentioned. So it's really fun. It's just a guy and his handheld camera. I had no crew, nobody around. It's just me and all these people telling real stories.
So, Seth, what they should have done is given you more awards, one for cameraman, one for voice recordist, and one for producer. I mean, that's unbelievable. What camera was it, can I ask you?
It was just a Sony handheld camera. I didn't have too much. I didn't expect it to turn into anything. As I like to tell people, you know, passion is always the fuel for all good things in life. So whether you want to write a song, write a book, make a movie, don't let negativity stop you. Like, I'll never get this done, or nobody will participate. You got to go for it. Jump in the water. It always gets warm.
Seth, I totally agree with you. I'm on the same track. We're going in the same direction. But let me say, what an amazing career you've had. And I'm just saying, you look young.
Thank you so much. I'm 60.
Yeah, but I'm 62. So okay. And I never tell people my age, but I might as well tell you. But I tell you what, you look like you're 40.
Oh, thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you so much.
You must work out. Not that it matters, but you must have your own gym.
No, nothing crazy, you know, just, but I'm consistent. That's the thing. I like to work out a good amount of time, but not for hours and hours by any stretch, you know.
Can I ask you, when the creativity comes to you in a song, right? Like, for example, I can get it anywhere, but yeah. I've sort of like challenged myself. This is like good talking songwriter to songwriter. What I like to do is I might be in the car and I've got a nephew and he's classically trained. So he's got his little iPhone and I can't do keyboards while I'm driving the car. You got to concentrate on the road.
That's right.
High, right?
Yes.
So what happens is I might get the idea of two words or two sentences, and yeah. then I'll sing the melody, you'll find the key, and then I'll go and record the song, right?
That's the way to do it.
I don't like doing that complete songs.
No.
I don't know how you do it, but I like it when it's more of a challenge. If you've got something, then when you're ready to record, then you can improvise and do it on the spot. That's just me.
That's right. Well, some songs, I Tell It to My Heart, took about 10 minutes to write. It just flowed right out. Everything just happened. But other songs I've had for years, maybe 10, 20 years, and they've just been a piece. And there's always been a problem with the song. So every time I picked it up and I said, okay, that's never going to make it. And then one day you sit down and the little thing that you can fix, one word sometimes, unlocks the whole song. So you never know. All your children don't grow up to be the same size.
But you know the best one I had, Seth, right? I'm going back to my early days, right? I had two separate songs. So I got sick of it. I put it together.
There you go.
Make one because right. I couldn't do the two.
Well, let me just say something about that. There are no, that's the beauty of art in general, whether it's painting, whether it's books, whether it's songs, anything like that. There's no rules to it. And we're very used to going to school and, you know, being very regimented. And that's all fine, too. I'm not saying anything bad about that. But that's the fun of songs. You can say, wait a minute, I could take that piece of a song and put it with that, like you've just mentioned. And then it's something really special. It's because there are no rules. You can just do that.
See, we're talking on the same road because I talk to a lot of young people, right? And I tell them, you want a 2-minute pop song? And they ask me, well, how do you get it?
Right.
Well, first of all, I said.
Yeah.
Get a drum beat and only go to 2 minutes.
There you go.
It's 2 minutes. You have to stop. Like, how easy is that? That is just the basic, right?
Another
thing that's a great trick too is you record a song, 3 minutes, 4 minutes, and then you cut out 2 minutes of the best part because it might have taken you 1 minute to warm up.
That's right. That's right. Exactly. That's right.
The basics, they crack me up. Now, you got to tell me about your duo, right, the Red Button.
Yes.
I was doing some research, and, of course, one of the Beatles producers in the early years, right, he was going to sign you up.
Yeah, Norman Smith, who –
That's really, the Hurricane Norman Smith.
Hurricane Norman Smith. I got to meet him. I filmed him for Beatles Stories, the documentary. And then I said, listen, could I send you some of the material from my band? Because we did a lot of Beatles-type songs from the late 60s, that kind of feeling. We didn't copy, and we didn't try and be that. We just had that in us, my partner and I. Beatles-esque type songs. Because nobody's writing Revolver or Rubber Soul today. You know, we wanted to do that. But not mimic. It's just what's in me. I grew up with it, so I wanted to do that. So anyway, yeah. So I sent it to him, and he wrote me back such a beautiful note. He was like, if I could sign you right now, you know, I would, and I would have signed you in the 60s. And then his book came out, his biography. He's never written one. And he was there in the early days, Norman Hurricane Smith. And I'm looking through the book, and he's got pictures, him and Paul, him and John, him and Ringo, him and George, and him and Seth. I couldn't believe he put a picture of me and him in there and dedicated a whole chapter to the time I went to see him at his house, and we became pen pals until he died. It was really a wonderful relationship. And when I got to meet Sir Paul McCartney, Paul said, okay, hit me with your question. You look like a Beatle guy. And it just came to me. I didn't have a chance to think. And I said, you know what? I just spent all afternoon with Norman Smith. He goes, oh my God, I haven't heard that name in so long. We got into a long conversation because I said the right name to him.
Amazing. And as I said, being there in Liverpool, you're in the heart of Liverpool. And I know our good friend Charles Rosenau, he's just actually sent something here. He does the Liverpool tours.
Yes.
Seth is my newest hero. he's done so many tours to Liverpool. It's amazing what he's done.
Fantastic. You can never get enough of those tours. I actually took a handheld camera around with that too, and I made a little movie that's on my website called Magical Mystery Tourist. You know, because the first time you see Penny Lane, the first time you see the roundabout, the first time you see so many, you know, so many, the barber shop and all those things and the homes, it's like visiting a planet that you've been, you know, you grew up with, you know what was on Mars and then you're there. It's crazy, you know? So it was very enjoyable to be there.
That's right. You live the song, Strawberry Fields.
That's right. That's right. When you see it, when you see the gate, and you see Strawberry Fields behind it, it's really quite a miraculous thing. It makes it real.
You know the story. They had the real gates outside and someone stole them. So what they did is they put new gates at the front and they look like the old ones, but the original ones are inside now. And they got tours and people should go and visit Strawberry Fields. Very important to go and visit it there.
Oh, yeah. Wonderful. Beautiful place.
But what a lot of people don't know is John, his house was near the back of it and he used to jump over the high fence. He didn't go through the gate.
That's right. Yes.
So Strawberry Fields was the playground at the back.
Yes. Fantastic. Just so great. That's right.
Tell me, how long are you still going with the red button or you've actually stopped your partner there? I'm just saying, Mike Rookbird, is he still writing songs with you, Mike?
You know what? The red button looks like we did our last record in 2017. We were played all over Sirius Radio and a lot of different places. And I think we've definitely parked it in a place. And I'm making a new solo record right now, which is coming out in May or June of this year. So I always switch off between the different projects, but now is the time for a solo record. So I'm quite excited about that.
That's great. Well, you did two albums with the button, as I said, the red button. She's about to cross
my mind.
That's it. And as far as Yesterday goes, so I mean, they're two great albums, aren't they? They got nominated for a lot of stuff too.
Yes, and our last album was a compilation of all of our, best of type stuff, and we added six new songs. So that's called Now It's All This, and it's everything in one.
Well, I mean, when you're a songwriter, I mean, you can write as many songs as you want. Yeah.
Yes, yes. But I'm very picky.
You're doing an anthology of your stuff? You can just put it in.
Well, after this record, after I do this album, the next one might be, outtakes and things like that. You know what I mean? But this one is a lot of brand new material. I'm quite excited about it. It came out of the blue. Last record I had was in 2016. So this one, it's not like I've been writing all this time for it. I just decided to do it in June. And then before I knew it, I was around the guitar so much and piano that I started writing a whole lot. So I can't wait to put it out, to be honest with you.
I'm sure the world can't wait either. But let me tell you this, Seth. A lot of people may not know that you're a big baseball memorabilia collector. Yeah. Now, I don't know how much of a collection you got left or you sold a bit of it or all of it. But you had some famous stuff. And let me tell you one of the things that amazes me. You got a baseball from Shea Stadium when the Beatles played and the Beatles signed that. Can you tell me the story behind that, how you got it?
Well, I went to a regular auction because I collect baseball memorabilia. And when, sometimes I think when everybody's looking right, maybe you should look left. And there in the corner, one of the lots was a baseball signed by the Beatles and dated the day they played the first famous Shea Stadium concert, the concert that opened up the entire music business to stadium concerts and all that. I mean, it was unheard of at the time. And it was a real American event and a world event. So I thought, this is an incredible opportunity. No one was really looking at that lot. And before I knew it, I just raised my hand and didn't put it down because no one was going to beat me. If I had to mortgage my house, I was going to buy that baseball. So I ended up getting it for not too much, actually.
Can I ask, Seth, have you still got the ball?
No, I don't. I put that in an auction in 2012.
So I'm look, I don't want to know your business. Are you able to tell me what you paid for it and sold it? You don't have to, or can you tell me what you sold it? It was an auction.
I bought it for about $7,000 and I sold it for about
$75,000. Unbelievable, Seth. You got so much time now to write songs.
Yeah. Well, you never know. You know, sometimes it's like buying a stock, but you got to really know is how much history is, how much does it have left to run? And I think people saw that differently than I saw it at the time. I saw it as a real piece of history, not just the Beatles on a baseball. There's only four of them.
Seth, this is amazing when you know what you're doing with stuff like that and to make money, because I did a lot of research on you, right? You can tell. Some guests I don't have to, some guests I do, with you I had to. But let me tell you, there's a ball, a baseball ball, if I'm correct, that you sold for over $400,000. Is that correct?
Yes, yes.
Tell me the story about that.
Well, in 1986, the Mets were playing, the New York Mets were playing the Boston Red Sox, and a baseball in the last inning went through Bill Buckner's legs. And I won't go through the whole rigmarole of the game and stuff like that, but the ball went through his legs. It was collected by the umpire. It ended the game. The umpire ended up giving it to one of the Mets guys, and it went up for auction in 1990, and Charlie Sheen, the actor, won it. And he sold it for $93,000. Well, 12 years go by, and he put it up for auction. And again, no one was looking at that. They were looking at some other thing, and I bought it for a discount, $63,000. And I held on to it, because it was a very famous piece. And then the auction came up in May of 2012, and I didn't know. Two guys were going after, and it only takes two to light a fire. And before you know it, it was up to $420,000, and it was just announced only now that it was the owner of the New York Mets that bought the ball, and he said he's going to put it in a museum at Shea Stadium, or at, you know, a Citi Field where the Mets play. But what he doesn't know is that I already donated it to the Mets for many years, so they had it in their museum for many years before that. They returned it to me, but I'm saying that it's really been – I wanted the fans to see it for a long time, you know.
You know, Seth, this is amazing. Just even talking now about the memorabilia. No wonder you got time, as I said, to sit back and do songs.
Yeah.
It's just, these are amazing stories, really.
Thank you.
This is one of the most riveting interviews I've done, because you can see I've done my research.
Yeah, very much. Yes. Thank you. I appreciate that.
Yeah, but I really appreciate you being candid and telling everyone out there, because there's so many baseball fans out there. And I mean, apart from memorabilia, you got the eye for what can appreciate in value. This is better than stocks.
Well, let me mention something to you about, you know, I think creativity, something that you don't need a lot of money to make money or to do things that are really fabulous. What I did in my collection, I just didn't put out a credit card. I created baseballs. Like if there was a famous event, you know, there's lots of different panels on a baseball. If there was one big famous play, I found everybody that was alive that took place in that play, and I sent it to their homes, and I had them write what they did on the play. I call them history balls. And I have a lot of those baseballs. I must have 100 of them, of all the famous plays in baseball. But with everybody, I made the catch when he hit the home, you know, when he hit the ball on the other. I threw the pitch where that ended the game, all those things. So I did a lot of research, and those things cost nothing. But they're so much fun, and they gain in value, and they're just, you know, they're the real pride of. And I didn't sell those, you know, because those are the ones I really love.
They're story balls, are they?
They're story balls. They're story balls.
Well, they're anybody can do what? Them. You've got 100 of those, have you?
Yeah. Well, I'm saying that anybody can do that. I think anybody can do anything and get pleasure out of it if they tap into their creativity.
Man, I've never even heard of that, that you go around and get everyone to do it. But it's also hard to get them to sign the ball, isn't it? It's not easy.
Well, you know, I write to them beforehand. I tell them I'm a songwriter, and they rarely hear from songwriters. So they were pretty happy to do it, to be honest with you.
Seth, I just want to say, can you tell everyone your links where you are on the net?
Sure. You can find me my website, where you can hear my music, read my books, see my artwork, and see my Beatles movie is realseth.com, realseth.com, realseth.com. And keep up with all the news and just see all the work I've ever done. And I'm also on Facebook. If you just type in Seth Swirsky, and I'm public. So you'll always see my posts up there, and obviously on Instagram as well, Seth A. Swirsky.
Seth, you might want to write a book about your life because it sounds fascinating. What I'm suggesting is you don't have to go hardbound. You can go digital, right? Save a lot of money.
Well, can I mention something to you? On my website, realseth.com, there's a thing called Timeline, and it shows, you know, what I did in the different years. But underneath it in the drop-down bar, it says Stories. And I put my 30 best stories of, you know, all these little stories. They're two paragraphs long, how I wrote with this guy, how I went to the White House, how I went, different things that just kind of happened. So
yeah, but there's your book there. You can just get a digital cover and go, says 30 greatest stories as an ebook. It takes like 5 minutes to put it together and put it out. That's amazing. You are amazing, Seth. I take my hat off to you. Just amazing man, amazing songwriter, amazing filmmaker, amazing baseball collector. I mean, what more do you say? The only thing that's left now is to do the song again. Tell it to my heart. I gotta hear a little bit before you go and we'll say goodbye.
Tell it to my heart. Tell me I'm the only one. Is it really love or just a game? Tell it to my heart. I can feel my body rock every time you call my name.
We got that groove happening for you. So from Plastic EP and Seth Swirsky, we say goodbye to the world. Thanks again, Seth. Just a fantastic interview.
Thank you so much. I really enjoyed it, and I'm honored. Thank you.
Pleasure.